Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Just Say Sports. My name is Rob Galtere. We are filming, or we are live here at beautiful Alvernia College Town, 4th and Penn Street in Reading, live on September 27th. With me again, Chris Barto. Chris, these are nice digs.
Very nice, Rob. Beautiful setup here.
I mean, Alvernia did it right. It is a beautiful setup. BC TV getting all, not 100% situated, but they got the studio, they got the control room, some editing room, still moving some things in. Glass, you know, we could see, we're like the Today Show. You could actually, they should actually, people would be giving us the finger if they flipped us around.
That is correct.
Going
we
that
have
way.
Moved up.
But we can at least watch what's going on, the scenery going by. Yeah. So much to talk about. Wow, it's been a little while since we've been on. Everything's percolating right now. Let's talk about our summer topic that we've just kind of been following, and that is the most dreadful team to watch in baseball. They just won't put us out of our misery,
right?
Those Phillies.
Yeah, I was thinking the other day about the marks we talked about, final 60 games, what the record had to be, final 50 games, what the record had to be. And pretty much all along, all summer, we said 10 games over 500 minimum to be in contention.
Right.
Well, if they win out, they'll be 11, and we both know they're not going to win out.
Right. And if they win out, they win the division.
Right. And we both know that's not going to happen.
That's not going to happen. I mean, this team had an opportunity. They had seven games with the Orioles and the Pirates. Five of them were decent, and they bookended them with a pair of shutouts to guys with 7 point something ERAs.
Yeah, that pretty much sums up the season. You couldn't lose more than one of those games, let alone two, by a shutout. It's just mind-boggling. And, you know, without Bryce Harper, they're not even 500 right now, probably. So, yeah, they haven't put us out of our misery officially, but in my mind, they have.
Now, they have a shot, I think, game one, Zach Wheeler.
Mm-hmm.
So that just, and that'll be the typical Phillies. Let's get, okay, still alive, you know, still in it. And Aaron Nola, probably say the fourth thing in game two of that series at Atlanta, will officially put the dagger in.
I know I've been driving you and our buddies nuts, but it's come true. Play the over against Aaron Nola for the other team.
Yeah.
And it hits 75% of the time.
Occasionally he throws that great game where you're thinking, oh, wow, you know, Nola's got to figure it out. He's got his stuff. And he comes out the next game, curveball.
And at lunch today, I was looking at some of their stats, and I think the most overrated stat possibly in Phillies history is Aaron Nola's 219 strikeouts this season.
Does he really have 219 strikeouts?
Yes.
I just think it's been a dreadful year from him.
That has to be the most useless use of strikeouts in history, to have that many and the ERA and the record he has to go with it.
I don't know how many times this year it's come into a big situation where he can get out of a jam and it's the 8 or 9 hole hitter and he doesn't get out of it.
Yeah, it's...
Because it's easy to put a curveball into play when you know it's coming.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to hit it hard. You just need to bloop it. He gives up a ton of soft hits.
Yeah, it's beyond disappointing what he's put out on the field this year.
Okay, percentage of Phillies winning these next six games?
5.7. What do you say?
You're quite the optimist. I was more on the 3.2.
Yeah.
It's not happening, is it?
No. Nope. Not in 2021.
Okay. Bryce Harper, putting into context his year. The only thing one of the Schmidt years, maybe 81, the Ryan Howard year where he had 50 homers and just every game down the stretch, it seemed like he was hitting a bomb.
Yeah, you bring up Schmidt, and he was on the broadcast Saturday talking about Bryce's year, and he was at a loss for words, saying, I don't know if there's ever been a better season in history. I think there has been, but Schmidty's obviously in awe of what he's done. Because when you look at the rest of the lineup, there's a couple guys hitting over 250, and the rest is hitting 220, 210, and Bryce is hitting 310 plus.
It's with no one behind him.
No.
Unless you count Real Muto's 270, a soft 270.
Barry, yeah.
I mean, how many times has he had McCutchen behind him?
Mm-hmm.
Brad Miller.
Yeah.
There's some. And they somehow have a winning record. Now, you go back, the greatest season in Phillies history by a player, any player, is Steve Carlton in 72.
Without question.
27-10 for a team that won 53 games.
Something like that.
1.92 ERA and 300-plus strikeouts.
And probably pitched 340 innings, probably.
Right. I mean, he's the only reason that I continued staying interested in the season. And then they go on these little runs, and the schedule was wide open for them to do well.
Mm-hmm.
So
his at-bats have become must-see, just like Ryan Howard and Chase Utley used to be.
So before I move on to other topics, we'll talk about it a lot as the winter progresses and so forth, and we get to the hot stove. I mean, we're talking left field, center field, shortstop, bullpen.
Yeah, you absolutely can't go into next year with Didi as your shortstop. He needs to be moved, eat most of his salary if you have to, but he's got to go. I would not re-sign McCutchen.
So, I mean, these are a lot of positions, and there's no one in the minor leagues that is a potential starter. Vierling might be a platoon player.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a shame what happened with Hazley early in the season. That had potential to be some stability with production even, yeah. And it just fell apart.
I wouldn't mind if you can't get a second outfielder if you go with Ammoniak, Vierling, platoon. Try it. But then you need another outfielder. And the only way I think... But this weakens you. The only way you can get a quality outfielder, because they're not going to have the money to spend.
Probably not.
You know, after the Real Muto contract, that was really the last one, is to trade Aaron Nola. But then you're left with Eflin Gibson, Zach Wheeler.
Ranger.
Mm-hmm. And are we going to do bullpen game for an entire season? Pennant stretch, and they're doing bullpen games.
Isn't it nice to see that Padres rotation these days?
Vince Velasquez.
And Jake Arrieta.
Wow.
Pushing 7 and 8 ERAs.
Hard to believe they fell apart with those two. Yeah. Didn't see that one coming. So, okay, let's just, the Phillies will hopefully it'll be quicker rather than, you know, let's not pull fingernails, just put us out of our misery. Get it done. Go Bravos.
Mm-hmm.
Let's move on to next year. Of course, they could win 6 in a row. Braves come back and have to play. They sweep the Mets. They come back, have to play that last game against Colorado, ties it up. And you know who would pitch in if they tied the Braves? Game 163. Aaron Nola.
Turn out the lights. The party would be over at that point.
Hey, NFL game tonight. Eagles, right. Cowboys. How about them Cowboys?
Yeah, should be a good one.
Should be interesting.
What's your take on it?
I don't think they win. I think I think they're going to be close getting into the fourth quarter. And I could see them down like 3 or 4, driving, and then a pick six or a fumble that they run back, and then they lose by like 11 or 12. If I was betting it, I would bet the Cowboys, but I don't bet.
Point spread 4, Eagles underdog?
Eagles underdog, it's 3.5, 4.
Okay, yeah.
I'm surprised only 3.5.
Yeah.
And I've said it on this show a billion times, and it lived up to its truth. When Lane Johnson and Brandon Brooks are on the field, and they were on the field five solid quarters this year. They dominated for five quarters. They dominated the Falcons. They dominated the first quarter against the 49ers. Brooks got hurt, and you could just see it all unravel. They couldn't move the ball.
Yeah, I heard over the weekend arguments for both teams tonight why they thought either one would win, and I thought they were all pretty valid points. I would lean towards the home team, but then they talked about they have seven or eight guys who were injured.
Yeah, they're banged up. There's no question the Cowboys are banged up. But I think they also have the three best players on the field, and they're all on the field at the same time with Dak, Amari Cooper, and CeeDee Lamb.
Yeah, Amari Cooper was disappointing last week. Didn't have the production some had hoped for. But, yeah, I think they're a better team at home, as most teams are.
And it's their home opener.
Right, yeah.
Two road games.
Whoever wins is in first place in that NFC East.
Well, really, it's almost a must-win for the Eagles already, because Kansas City's coming up.
Angry.
Coming off a loss. Mm-hmm. You know, play for Andy, all that, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
When I say must-win, anything above seven wins would be considered a bonus for this team. Unless Lane and Brandon Brooks were healthy, the possibility of that was basically zero.
Yeah, it's frustrating when your key guys can't be out there when you need them.
Yeah.
But that's the NFL, I guess.
Yeah, and that's expected. That's why they drafted Landon Dickerson. So he's going to play tonight. Absolute stud at Alabama, but he's coming off a torn ACL. A second torn ACL. So how's that, you know, happening? It's a good game to start because the Cowboys' defensive line is completely banged up, and they can dominate that defensive line. But I just think that Cowboys' offense, once Dak gets going.
What'd you think about the play calling for the Eagles against San Francisco?
A little too well. You know what?
Especially down at the goal line.
Well, the goal line, and Sirianni took responsibility for that, as he should. I mean, that was why you're trying to fool a team. First of all, Jalen Hurst squats like 600 pounds. They keep showing that. Mm-hmm. Why is he not quarterback sneaking from the one?
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, he tried to be too cute.
Right.
Philly special.
Philly special, and the wide pitch and the. You know, it was a disaster. And you know what? Andy Reid had some classic boneheaded first-year disaster. So I hopefully Sirianni learned from it. But
did you know San Francisco has 22 coaches? And I heard another reason why that was a terrible call, because Greg Ward came into the game after not playing, and their coaches picked it out. Like that, and we're totally ready for it.
Yeah.
So.
Why, if you haven't used him all year and he was a former quarterback, why?
Yeah. But like you said, he's got to learn, and it's a young coach's mistake.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Yeah, but you know, Hurts had the two long passes. They should have ended up with touchdowns on both of them. I mean, Reagor steps out of bounds. Mm-hmm. But I, you know, Hurts did some good things. I mean, you're looking at him as a fan of an opposing team. After watching the fiasco of Fields and Zach Wilson and Trevor Lawrence yesterday.
Yeah, it's not college, is it?
It's not college. And Jalen Hurts did much more last year.
Oh, for sure.
In his first starts than these guys did.
With not a ton of talent
around
him.
No offensive line.
Yeah.
I don't understand the question of, can Hurts be the guy? He is the guy.
I would take him.
Are you really going to go next year and draft a quarterback again and have to go through what those teams are going through?
Send him down 95. They'll take him.
Yeah. Oh, you took McNabb.
No, thanks. Oh, that was terrible.
The memorable McNabb years.
Yeah. He couldn't even pad his stats in garbage time when they were losing by 20. That's how bad it was.
Yeah. Well, the dump off wasn't as effective.
To the shins? No.
And that's the one thing that Hurts does. He does hit the running backs in stride, whether they catch it or not. Mm-hmm. You know, Miles Sanders is not the most reliable. Your thoughts on the game?
The Eagles tonight?
Yeah.
Frankly, I'll be rooting for them. I'd rather see them win than Dallas. I don't know. I think both teams will be in the 20s. I think pretty close game.
Way to go out on a limb.
Yeah. Whoever has the ball last wins.
In case someone wanted to bet the game. 3.5, if that's what the line is right now. I didn't check.
Okay. I would stay away. I think it's a good number.
I think it's going to fall right on that number, 3.5.
Yeah.
Your Redskins defense a little shaky right now?
Wow, very disappointing. And
is that a defensive backfield issue, or is the defensive line struggling too?
No, the defensive line's not performing at all.
And that shouldn't be happening.
No pressure. And funny how two of them got real big contracts and just aren't performing like they did last year.
Yeah.
And frankly, Chase Young isn't either. He's probably getting double teamed, I assume. So the other guys should be making hay, and nobody is on that line. Secondary's okay. I mean, it's not losing games for them, but the line needs to be way better. And they've called them out pretty much every telecast.
Yeah.
That, you know, this vaunted defense is not playing nearly like they did last year.
I mean, that was just the thought all along that you know, and they still might be in it till the end. This NFC East, I don't think anyone's going to run away with it.
But no.
Just surprising that the Giants were able to pretty much score on every possession.
Yeah, it was very disappointing. They were totally fortunate to win that game, and they have Atlanta on the road this week, which is a must-win for them to get back to 2-2. And Atlanta's favorite, actually. So
are they really?
Yeah, I think it was 2.5 when I looked yesterday.
I did on a whim yesterday play the Atlanta Falcons after the Giants went up 14-7. I'm like, I could see the Giants losing this.
How many more games does Joe Judge have?
Oh, Joe Judge is a joke.
Yeah.
Can you imagine being your New York City? You've got not one, but two football teams.
Oh, I had that same conversation with my son yesterday.
And they cannot buy a win.
Yeah. Oh, man. Jets and Giants.
And if you, well, first of all, using a number two pick or whatever they did on Saquon Barkley on a running back.
Yeah, he's...
You build with lines. You could get a running back. You can get a running back anywhere.
Yeah, he's coming off the injury, but he's a little above average and not much more.
I'd go across the street to Queen's Gift Shop over there and find a running back. See how I brought in a little Redding to the new studio there?
Yeah, we got a really good one in Shillington right now.
Wow. Okay, my question to you, and I brought this up before and got... It wasn't an argument. It was just, no, okay, because there's a certain attachment to a former current NBA player, Lonnie Walker, in this town, as well there should be.
Yeah.
Is Governor Mifflin the best team in county history? If. Now, last year they would have won the state championship if they didn't have injuries in game, in that Pine-Richland game where they ended up playing guys who never even played before.
Right.
If they continue to roll, which really there's a good shot, because I don't know if there's anyone in Western PA this year that can even get in their way. They roll the way they're continuing to roll, and Nick Singleton is having the year that he's having. Do you at least consider Governor Mifflin having the best sports team in county history?
They would need to be up there. They're destroying teams and have not played an easy schedule.
No.
No game's been close. And we don't want to upset our fans in Exeter and followers there. That game's coming up in a couple weeks, I believe.
And they've got a number of Division I players, prospects.
Which should be a great, exciting game.
I don't know.
That's their, well.
That's the thing. I don't know. I don't know if anyone is even capable of competing.
I think the game they just played at Episcopal in Philly that I watched on YouTube was probably a good tune-up for the Exeter game because they did throw a lot, look down the field, which Exeter likes to do with their big guy, and hopefully they picked up some valuable experience in that game. But again, it wasn't close. And their margin of victory by the end of this season is going to be historic.
Okay, so maybe it's a question we ask after, and there's really no right or wrong answer, but I'm telling you.
If they win states, they will be up there legendary
status. Because that Reading basketball team, and I'm not taking away anything. I mean, last year's team was... I don't think Reading's team last year was as talented as the previous team, but man, that team last year was so scrappy. Mm-hmm. They were just a ball to watch, the way they went after people. I mean, they literally took the will out of Archbishop Wood, which just does not happen mm-hmm. to a seasoned team like that.
And there, being a local my whole life, there was some phenomenal Reading teams in the 60s and 70s with Pete Carrill and Jim Gineau. The Stu Jackson era, we know those people are they're not forgotten.
This has to go down, and I want people to enjoy why it's happening. You know, mm-hmm. whether you root against a local team or whatever, just sit back, and I'm just in awe of it. And I was in awe of it last year and was just so disappointed that, you know, all the injuries happened mid-game and three-touchdown lead against supposedly an unbeatable Pine Richland team who outscored everyone by a million points. Mm-hmm. You know, that ended up happening. But it's a question that could be answered down the line.
Nick Singleton is shattering the previous records.
And it's not just Nick Singleton. They basically used him as a decoy against Harrisburg. You know, I'm watching and I'm like, I don't even know if he's there. I'm watching on my phone. I don't even know he's in the game. And they're just marching up and down the field.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Harrisburg kids weren't quite sure what was happening.
Yeah. It was something.
Yeah.
Hey, this might be the last show we do where Ben Simmons is a Sixer. Is that a
promise?
Okay, what did the fans do wrong that Ben's so upset? They asked him to make a free throw. They encouraged him. They cheered every time he got to the line. You can do this.
And supposedly he hasn't used the fans as his reason for wanting to leave. But Doc Rivers is saying the fans are a problem and it's tough to play here.
Well, Danny Green
it's
said
not
the
easy.
Same thing.
Yeah.
I don't know if you saw Justin Anderson, remember former Virginia Cavalier, two tours with the Sixers.
Remember him. Yeah.
He said they know their basketball. They have expectations, and when you work hard, they're the most. You know, they love you.
Mm-hmm. You're not going to fool them.
No. No.
And it never gets brought up. This is a max contract player we're talking about.
Yes. Who was afraid to take a shot in the fourth quarter? It's that. That stumbling block of, I don't want to fail, so if I don't shoot, I'm not failing. If I don't drive to the basket, I won't get fouled, so I won't fail at the foul line.
Yeah. And
max contract, $30-some million, and he's afraid to miss.
And people want to say, well, Joel Embiid threw him under the bus. He answered a question honestly.
Yeah. Well, did you hear what he said? That Thibault should be the one upset because he called out Thibault for missing one of the free throws.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we had a basket and we ended up with 1 point and that was the end.
Yeah. Yeah. It's all excuses. It's all excuses.
Yeah.
It's all excuses.
He needs to go. All we can hope is that Daryl Morey makes a really good trade.
Yeah, but if you're going to get crap offers, you can actually take a team backwards. So if you end up with a Buddy Hield as your main focus. He's a negative value player. Mm-hmm. You make your team worse eventually by putting someone out there like that. So basically, you have to hold on to him till you get a positive deal. Now, Ben's not going to like it. Clutch Sports isn't going to like it. But that's the reality. You can't make your team worse by taking on someone else's problem or trash or...
No. Let him sit.
You got to.
Yeah. What's he going to do? He's got no leverage. Sixers have Tyrese Maxey to play the point.
Yeah. And give your given Thibault more minutes. And, you know, you don't have to solve your playoff problems the first 40 games of the season.
Absolutely not. No.
That is just a bunch of horses finding their mm-hmm. position, and then you'll get to the home stretch, and that's where you try to figure out where it all falls.
Yep.
Ryder Cup. Does the United States team go to Europe and win in 2 years, which doesn't happen very...
I believe so. They're scary good.
They are scary.
And young.
And I didn't realize how scary bad Europe is.
Oh, yeah.
Hovland, is he the only young stud they have?
John Rahm.
And Rahm.
Yes. Yep.
But literally, they threw out Sergio Garcia, Ian Poulter.
Casey Westwood.
Paul Casey, Lee Westwood.
Fitzpatrick.
It kind of reminded you of Phil Mickelson, Tiger Woods. Guys who were just not the best players anymore.
Mm-mm. No. What did they keep talking about? The world rankings. I can't remember what it was, but they were saying like 2, 3, 4, 5, 8, 9, 11, 12, something like that. We're all on the U.S. team.
And they played like it.
Yeah.
And they seem to, they love the, now it's great, it's easy to love winning. Mm-hmm. And but they just seem to feed off of it. Like, I want to see if they all come back President's Cup.
Right. And they set a new record, scoring record, with 19 points in the 28-point format.
Yeah.
So we talked about Nick Singleton's records, the Ryder Cup record. We failed to mention the Phillies bullpen record for ineptitude.
Although I did look, the Braves have had 27 blown saves. So it's only a seven blown save difference.
Yeah, so I think...
Okay, I've got probably 15 seconds. You tell me Giants-Dodgers, who wins that division?
Giants.
Can the Cardinals beat the Dodgers in that one game?
Yes.
Boy, wouldn't that be awful? For all the money those Dodgers have spent. I think the Dodgers end up winning the whole thing anyway. I think they'll figure it out. Hey, thanks for coming out.
Great to be here.
Great here. Love the digs.
Alvernia
College Town.
Yeah.
Sometime walk by, 4th of Penn Street Reading. Beautiful, beautiful complex here, and they're still building it. So that's it for Just Say Sports. I'm Rob Galtier. We'll be back. We're always on the second and fourth Monday of each month. That's the easiest way to find us. Have a great evening.